Thank you very much for giving me that opportunity to address you on a subject that is very close to my heart. I believe that science holds a key to transform the countries of sub-Saharan Africa, and that is why science education is one of my top priorities as World Bank Vice President for Africa. Science is central to just about everything today in any part of the world. There is no country anywhere which has been able to sustain high levels of economic growth and increase its productivity without expanding access to science and technology and without nurturing innovation. Let's take a look at India, which began with four Institute of Technology in the 50s. Today, it hosts an IT-enabled industry worth $1 billion, supporting 12 million middle-income jobs. This is the power of technology. But technology is not just about IT. In Brazil, investment in agricultural research led to a 77% increase in agricultural productivity between 1985 and 2006. While we are on the subject of Latin America, I should point out that Latin American countries have an average of 500 scientists involved in R&D per 1 million people. In Africa, we have very few scientists when you consider our needs. Right now, there are only 17 scientists involved in R&D per each million people in Ghana, and 38 per 1 million in Nigeria. So the task ahead of us is very clear. We have to build the capacity to build it quickly. Why quickly? It's because we have now an unprecedented opportunity in terms of economic growth. And our countries have been growing very fast at a rate which has been well above the world average. In 2012, the economies of sub-Saharan Africa have been growing at about 5.8% if you exclude South Africa. Increasing capacity in science and technology is crucial to sustain economic growth and competitiveness in Africa. It's also a vital tool with which to tackle development challenges that face the continent, from health services to energy security and climate. Education is a pipeline to scientific knowledge, so investing in education must be at the heart of advancing science in Africa. Investment at all levels is necessary, but investment in higher education is particularly important. Higher education and research institutions now have a unique opportunity to partner with industry in generating the knowledge that is needed in African societies.
In Africa, poverty eradication and sustainable development need solutions which are African-led, African-owned, and African-specific for Africa's problems. Social, natural, and applied scientists need STI policies defined by African stakeholders that are built upon African scientific capacities and targeted at the African context. Such scientific independence is key to delivering solutions to Africa's poorest and most excluded.
Africans generally consume knowledge production in the world. We don't produce for ourselves or produce for humanity as a whole. We tend to just consume what others have produced.
When we talk about Africa and scientific independence, it's all about the production of relevant knowledge and relevant whatever the creations. The question really is, how relevant is it to advancing the plight of Africans? And I think that is what it's about.
I think that scientific independence is critical for African development, and Africa will have achieved scientific independence when it can both finance and lead research, scientific research, that is aimed at solving African problems. And that means research that they undertake on their own or collaborative research with other regions outside of Africa.
I would like to thank all of you for engaging with the important topic of science in Africa. Science cannot grow in isolation. It's a constant exchange of ideas. The success of scientific innovation depends on collaboration, and partnership and knowledge sharing are fundamental to enabling African economies to meet their scientific needs and drive their own scientific agenda.
Science requires international collaboration which requires the sharing of expertise and resources. Indeed, if one looks at the UK and the US, much of the scientific strength of these countries is premised on international collaboration. So Africa should develop greater scientific independence, but that shouldn't be at the expense of scientific collaboration.
We need to have collaborative approaches with people with skills that are African and also with the different kinds of knowledge experts from outside. We actually need to have participative approaches so that Africans are not necessarily seen to be reinventing the wheel.
Well, there are some questions of physical infrastructure. Having the right facilities in which undergraduates and particularly postgraduates and researchers can conduct the best science.
And also to be able to maintain this technology, you must have the manpower, you must have the personnel who understand that technology and who can maintain it. Because many times you find technology has been acquired and it's, you know, it's sitting there like a white elephant. Probably you don't have people who know how to operate it. And, you know, even when it breaks down, they don't know what to do.
There's also a barrier of the human infrastructure. We want the best scientists in Africa to continue their work in Africa. Yes, traveling abroad, collaborating with others abroad. But they need to be on the continent, in country, contributing to the scientific development. That way, we not only get great science now, we build great science for the future.
And if the scientists are not trained up to the most advanced level, they will be lagging behind. We need to do cutting-edge research in Africa. If the scientists are not well remunerated, I don't think we are going to make much progress. In science.
Because it's unimaginable. People can't imagine you being a scientist because you can't think about it. Can you imagine going to my country in Senegal, saying to your mum you want to become a scientist? They're not going to believe you. It's just not something that will happen at all. So I think it's because we haven't decoded science. So people really think, you know, there's no need for science in Africa, for example.
The curriculum, the African curriculum, it does include science, but science at a very theoretical level. Even the teachers don't actually, have manuals, books, websites where they can go and find materials where they can actually read and develop themselves when it comes to science.
Actually, it is government commitment. In funding, government commitment, understanding that science is important for development, not just concentrating on everyday life, like poverty and so on. They need to commit. They cannot rely on international agents like you solely to fund them. They've got to put money aside, substantial amount of money aside for science. But even when countries have done that, like in South Africa, there's a problem of what we call innovation chasm. Going from research, science into reality and making products and improving technology that we are trying to use now is still a bit of a problem. We haven't really caught up in terms of developing things like that.
And of course, trying things and trying and failing things, that costs. So we need to actually begin to partner with people who are prepared to understand that R&D, research and development, can actually lead to failed designs, which cost money. But then it is part and parcel of what growth is about.
We need to invest in the younger people. In many of the research institutions, you find lots of older people, people who are either in their 40s or 50s or 60s, and you find less of the younger generation. I think we need to invest.
I would like to congratulate the Institute for the work that it's done so far with young people and to encourage you to continue to engage with the post-2015 process as we strive towards putting young people and the planet at the centre of the next development agenda. I wish you a successful meeting.